So it was a lot of fun, my beloved, to think about how I would introduce you. And yeah, among the things that I love about Jack is his remarkable gift of storytelling. We have been partners and married for 21 years, and I am still hearing stories I have not heard before. Jack's been shaped by his origins in the prairies of Saskatchewan and very much by his time in CUSO, which is akin to the Canadian Peace Corps, where he was engaged in post-war reconstruction in Ghana and Nigeria. And you were only in your 20s at the time.
Mm.
You are a loyal friend. You still have friends and connections from your university days and days in West Africa. And you're a great traveler. And I love that we've had a chance to travel and work together in New Zealand and Australia and the UK and Uganda. And I've been thinking about how much you are a natural leader and problem solver with an unwavering moral compass. You have an amazing eye, which I can see in the photography that you've done and continue to do, and you're a brilliant listener and graphic facilitator.
Mm.
I love your tender heart, and you are fiercely loyal, a family guy, a devoted friend, and my boyfriend.
Well. sort of ditto in reverse, but Lynda's had a rough haul since meeting me. She started off in Ohio and then migrated actually via the Northwest, where she almost climbed Mount Helens, except it disintegrated first. But spent 25 years in Rhode Island, where she was Miss Flipchart and Markers and very much instrumental in the deinstitutionalized process. And if I'm not wrong, actually, I think Rhode Island was the first state to close all of its institutions. And Lynda was very much part of the engine under that. And in the 25 years, the last nine, she was the executive director of developmental disabilities for the state. And interestingly enough, a story she tells, but it's a good one, is that when she got this job, several people said, "Oh, good, now you'll be able to enforce the rules that everybody's going to have a path or a map or some kind of planning session." And she said, "Actually, it's really good I've got this job, because under no circumstances while I'm breathing is that going to happen." And her rebel tendencies and creativity have made a mark in Rhode Island and beyond, right across the country. Lynda met me shortly after my wife and partner, Marcia Forrest, passed in 2000. And I was in very bad shape. That's fairly common that this kind of thing happens, but I was in desperate need of rescue. And Lynda was my rescuer. And so we met, and although I couldn't convince her to immediately move to Toronto, we did get married in 2002, and she migrated to Toronto in 2005, and we have been on the road ever since, creating mischief wherever we can. I think I asked her, if we were getting together, are there any places you'd like to go? And she said, yes. New Zealand, Australia, and Alaska. So we did those within the first year. And we haven't stopped since. We've been running summer institutes, which are now phased down and reinvented in the ideas that matter events that we're hosting. And although we have been teaching maps and path everywhere and anywhere forever, we swore we'd never do it virtually. And now we are. And the story continues. So it's so Lynda is now not only a brilliant facilitator, absolutely master facilitator, she's also the queen of Zoom and of Padlet, and makes it possible for us to do the things we do together. And that makes life a pretty good adventure. So I think that's Lynda.
Thank you, JC.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting to hear the story that you tell, because it really speaks to our purpose today. Lisa, when you got in touch with us in the early spring, your invitation was to share what was on our minds. So what do you want us to talk about, we said, and you said, please tell us what you're thinking about. So our purpose today is to really share with you what matters most to us these days in thinking about person-centered ways of working and the origin story of circles of support and maps and path, which are two of the family of person-centered planning approaches. There are many others, and we know some that folks are actively using other approaches, and we'll talk a little bit about these two. And there's really are some common elements to any of these patterns of conversation. And so we've really been thinking about what it means to really think about who we are in the work and the way that our interior condition has so much to do with the quality of our listening and our capacity to walk with one another. And we want to think a little bit about some of the practices that really strengthen our interior condition and who we are and our capacity to be present and deeply listen. Because much like the story you told about that Rhode Island moment, we believe we really are at risk of person-centered planning and practices becoming institutionalized and systematized, which we think will take the heart and soul from the work. And we'll fall short of genuinely listening to people and discovering what matters to them and bringing folks who've been marginalized into everyday community life and community membership. And so we've called this the Roots of Inclusion. I'm going to turn it to you.
And our intention is that person-centered ways of working are to keep open the possibilities for people by listening to their dreams and revealing what really matters, discovering their gifts and capacities.
We think our work is to build relationships that support a person to become a valued friend and to act as a contributing citizen.
We've been listening to many things, including Vivette Murthy, the Surgeon General, who, in case you don't quite buy it from us, one of his most profound commitments right now is to joy. And he says, life is meant to be joyful, and we need to walk each other toward joy. And that's the Surgeon General talking about the health of the nation. We need to focus on joy. Nothing is more powerful than people being loved and cherished. And that's a medical analysis. Love and cherish. So a quick story about love and cherish from early history. This is a picture of Ed Roberts when one of his dreams was to swim with a dolphin. There isn't time here to tell you how complicated it was for a man who used a respirator and needed to invent a floating wheelchair that was that wouldn't electrocute him. But there he is kissing a dolphin. And that metaphor says it all. But you want to hear it direct from Ed.
In order to change the old attitudes, we got to get out in society. We got to be seen. We got to be the neighbors. We got to be the lovers. We got to be the friends. We got to be seen in a very natural way. Disability is a part of life, and some of us are going to have it. And some of us are going to have it young, and some of us are going to have it older. But whenever it comes, our job, you and I, is to make sure that we know that we don't have to put somebody in an institution. We can have high expectations of them in their future. And by helping them begin to take control of their own lives, they can go back to work, or go to work, or dream what they want to dream and make their dreams come true like we all do.
Ed was beginning this journey in the 60s, believe it or not, when he was the first student with complex disabilities to crack the barriers at UCLA. And then he went on with many other barriers that he broke. But there are many, many people on this journey over time that we can rely on as the people who develop the foundations on which we are building. But we want you to remember exactly what he said, because it's so powerful. In order to change the old ways, we've got to get out in society. We've got to be seen. We've got to be the neighbors. We've got to be the lovers. We've got to be the friends. We've got to be seen in a very natural way. Disability is a part of life, and some of us are going to have it, and some of us are going to have it young, and some of us are going to have it older.
But whenever it comes, our job, you and I, is to make sure that we know that we don't have to put somebody in an institution. You can have high expectations of them and their future, and that by helping them to take control of their lives, they can go back to work or go to work and dream what they want to dream and make their dreams come true like we all do.
Robert, someone worth paying attention to way back when and fresh today. Vivek Murthy also introduced us to Father Greg Boyle in Los Angeles, who has spent his time working with gang members. And just to make the point that this is about everybody, he says, traumatized folks are inclined to cause trauma. Cherished people will find their way to the joy of cherishing themselves. And many of us are going to be dealing with people who have various kinds of trauma. They need to be cherished in order to invent the futures. So our job is to build a culture of beloved belonging, a safe place to infuse hope. A different way of saying exactly the same thing is that our job is to seed possibilities. We have absolutely no idea which seeds are going to thrive or where or when, but our job is to sow the next generation of possibilities. When we do that, and when we look out, we see a world of infinite diversity. And that's what makes it work. Not sameness, but diversity. Diversity is essential to our survival. So we need all of us, not some of us. And because of that diversity, when we have freezing temperatures and forest fires and floods and drought and disease, the diversity will allow new life, new possibility to emerge.
In this slide, you see in the top photo to the far left, with the two braids, is Marcia Forrest. And sitting in that wheelchair with the tray is a very young at the time Judith Snow, and to her right is Norm Kuntz. And there is this fabulous drawing by Bob Persky, by Robert Persky, to the right, with people who are surrounding Judith. And I asked Jack, in thinking about the origins of this work, if you would share the connection you had through Marcia to Judith, and a bit about that journey and the origins of Circles of Support.
Yeah. Well, now, if we're looking for straight line logic, there isn't any. But Marcia was teaching education students, special education students at York University in Toronto. And on arriving, she discovered that although these students were destined for classrooms with lots of students with different abilities, none of the people they were exposed to in terms of the teaching faculty had a disability. So she just looked around, and there weren't many students with disabilities at York at that time. This is the early 70s. But she found Judith Snow and Norm and a few others and invited them into her class, because she thought the best possible teaching was to have them be part of the faculty. Well, she invited Judith to a couple of classes and then invited her home to our house. Well, Judith was somewhat stunned, because she'd never been invited home to anyone's house. And Marcia mentioned that, because I hadn't yet met Judith, that she had a pretty big wheelchair, and we had 22 steps at the front of the house, but only 3 at the back. So I built a makeshift ramp at the back of the house. And when Judith arrived, we rolled her into the house, up her new ramp, and had dinner. And little did we know how big a deal that was. So she stayed the night. And that night became an infinite variety of nights over the next many decades. But what really happened was that shortly thereafter, Judith graduated from York University and graduated from support that was available to students to a nursing home, which was the only quote unquote facility in Ontario that could provide her with any support beyond what her parents could do. And they could no longer, they were aging and just couldn't do the heavy lifting. So she ended up in a nursing home. And when we went to visit her, we were outraged and couldn't figure out what to do. But Judith figured out what to do. She said, "I'm not going to die here. I absolutely refuse. I'm not going to die in a nursing home." So she drove her wheelchair with her thumb and left. She just escaped. And she drove over to Peter Dill's office. Peter's one of the people in the Persky drawing, and said, "I'm going to stop talking now, because I'm tired of the battle. If you're going to figure this out, you better do something now." And so Peter called Marcia and I, and I went and collected Judith and brought her to our house and got her upstairs. And then we looked at each other and said, "Now what?" And the "now what" was actually the core of the beginning of all this work. We called all the people we knew who knew and loved Judith and said, "This is an emergency. We've got to figure out how to, if we want to keep Judith alive, we have to figure this out now." So people arrived and we sat up all night. And by morning we had some essentially committees. We had a committee on finance and a committee on housing and a committee on jobs. And we divided up the work, because Judith had no money, no place to live, no attendant care. She was in desperate shape. But by morning we had organized, you know, a routine of volunteers to provide her 24-hour support, and we began the battle to get her a full life. And, you know, that battle went on essentially for decades, but it led to her getting the first ever in Canada individualized support, a grant for that, and housing and all kinds of things. So she became, and I signed off on it because I was the president of Frontier College, so I had an agency that I could legally use, sort of. And I signed a contract that we would hold the money for Judith and promised on a stack of Bibles that I wouldn't tell anybody, because it was going to be a secret arrangement. So we only had a press conference immediately after to announce that this was the first of what we hoped would be many, many more opportunities for people to get appropriate funding. And although many people were pretty annoyed about that, it worked. Now, Judith called us the Joshua Committee because we knocked down walls. And the Joshua Committee is the origin of circles of support, circles of friends. And this is an element of the sort of the underlying element in all our work, that life is about relationships. And as you start to think about it, step one is to notice who you got, who's in your life. And although there are many ways to do this, this is the one we developed. Because unless you stop and think about it, you actually don't notice. But what you will notice is this is actually pretty close to what Judith was when she was in the nursing home. There was her mom and dad, and there were 44 medicalized professionals, not bad people, but they were doing their jobs. And that meant that she actually was dying in the nursing home because they couldn't do what was necessary to keep her alive. They were just doing their jobs. And so we had to invent another way.
And remarkably, Judith said this, loneliness is the greatest disability, and it would be much more helpful and powerful to think about whether people are mildly lonely, moderately lonely, severely lonely, or profoundly lonely, and use that as a point from which to take action to build connections and relationships. Which really leads you to this.
So what we discovered in doing this was that if you begin to notice who's in your life and who's possible, if you fill the third circle by joining things where you meet other people, it's a way to begin building a network of relationships for almost anyone, anywhere, and anyone can do that. It just takes a little courage. And so one of the adventures we got into, and there are an infinite number, including some in Who's Drawing the Lines, one of Judith's books, Judith became an exhibit in the Royal Ontario Museum. It was because they needed to do some stuff and we thought this would be pretty entertaining. But Judith's artwork, she used laser eagles. She instructed someone to hold the brush while she told them where and how to paint. But so there was an exhibition of her paintings along with some others at the Royal Ontario Museum in a high traffic area. And what happened typically was Judith be there, and the kids would see this big chair and all this gear and we'd be fascinated. So they'd surround Judith and start chatting and having a good time. And you know, a few moments later, parents would race in to rescue the children from their encounter with Judith, at which point she could begin a discussion with parents. And so there were these amazing discussions that happened with children and parents and citizens, and it was a wonderful event. And so, go ahead.
One of the things that was really remarkable about the preparation for this exhibit was that Judith shared stories, and the Royal Ontario Museum made several short videos and also posted some of the things that she had to say. And this was one of them. Being an advocate for inclusion draws almost exclusively on anger, courage, and righteousness. Being an artist has given me space to express ambivalence, awe, playfulness, fear, and most of all, love.
Here's Judith with her paintings, and here's what she had to say in one of her poems. They said, she'll never walk, she'll die before she's six, she'll always live with her parents, there's no point in her going to school. You will never have any friends. Your kind belongs in chronic care. You don't understand how this works. This isn't art. And then the Judith line. They were right. I never learned to walk. And so here's Judith live up front in a short story she tells.
I was about six, and I was with my dad. He was helping me get dressed for the morning. And he told me a story. He told me that he had heard on the radio that doctors in California were killing children with Down syndrome because they felt those babies could never grow up to have a life that was worth living. And then he went on to tell me that when he was a boy, he grew up in Biddeford in England. And what they did then was they grew potatoes and they raised cows and sheep. And he said a person with Down syndrome was hardly even noticed in their town because people with Down syndrome could grow potatoes and raise cows and sheep just like everybody else. But if I had been born at the time he was a boy, they would have strangled me by the time I was 3 years old because they wouldn't have known what I could do when I grew up. So I asked him, why are you keeping me alive? And he said, maybe you'll find the answer.
And her life and focus were through so many teachings in the way she lived and listened. And she teaches us still to listen for gifts, to listen deeply for visions, and to dream, and to notice that listening to dreams and vision gives us direction. And we'll discover the seeds in the dream of what really matters to a person. Listening in between the lines. Listening for the gifts that a person has to contribute in the community are revealed if we are really listening for them. And she holds this really big question. In the next slide, Jack. What are some of the ways we can take the seeds of a dream and plant them in our community right now? How can we be at work with the person's dream and their gifts right now?
And so I'm flipping back to Father Boyle, mm-hmm. who essentially says the same thing differently. Because many people have had traumas in their lives, and we need to figure out ways to soothe them before we can begin to heal. So our work is to challenge the lethal absence of hope. Absence of hope is deadly. And then we need to create places of tenderness where people are valued and seen, where people are feel less invisible. You see, that means we have to be with people. We have to be proximate. We have to do things together. And in the big scheme of things, it helps to remember that systems change when people change. And people change when they feel cherished. People change when they feel cherished. It's the relationship that heals. It softens people in their heart, because this is a matter of the heart. That's where the change begins. And can you do this? You better believe it. If you are the proud owner of a pulse, you have the capacity to connect and be in and receive relationships. Any of us, all of us, anywhere, all the time.
So we think the work very much centers in investing in relationships and connections and deep listening and being clear about our purpose and intention. And we think about the big overarching questions that fall under what more is possible. They're really grounding questions under the approaches that we follow to person-centered ways of working and planning, holding this big question: how can we make relationships and build organizations based on the realization there is no one whose contribution we do not need? And how can this person show up in community life as a valued friend and contributing citizen? It's the cornerstone that guides us as we keep holding that question. We wanted to share, this is the template, this is the pattern that's followed in the MAPS process, which begins listening to some stories from the person's life, invites a person to think without limits about their dream, recognizes and respects the shadow side and the nightmare, and listens in between the story, the dream, and the nightmare for somebody's gifts. And so it's grounded in the gifts, in that yellow arrow that you see coming up from the ground above the horizon. And think about, where would those gifts, Judith's question, where would those gifts be welcomed and needed in the community? How could they be at work? And then ends with action. Very reflective process, actually. And we've got two short videos to bring this to life. One is of Caden, who we met in Alaska, and he is 5. And then the next video is Micah, and this was when he was about 25 in Syracuse, New York. He said it's time for another map.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata, ain't no peasant craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days. It's our problem-free philosophy.
Hakuna Matata.
Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog.
very nice.
Thanks.
He found his aroma like a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul, though I seem thick skinned.
I have a whole stuff that's like fire, and I'm arguing it, so you can see that, and on the fire, and this is a pretty cool job, and there's smoke.
That's great.
It's our problem free. Philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
And so after, you know, we started with circles, then we had maps, and then we invented path. And we're not going to go through the steps here, except that you invest a goodly amount of time and imagery in thinking about your North Star, the place you want to go without limit, and then essentially figure out how you're going to get there. But the best way to describe it is listen in to Leslie.
Leslie White had an opportunity to receive person-directed planning through Plan Toronto. The process involved gathering a group of people who knew her to help her discover and develop new connections and new opportunities to participate and share her gifts throughout her community.
Leslie is a young adult who has always been involved with her church. She has a very strong faith, and she's also occasionally gone to a convent where she has gone for retreats. But always she has gone with her mom, and she's always been known in those settings as Barbara's daughter. And people really didn't know what her interests were or what her passions were or what her dreams for the future were. So we actually gathered together a group of people around Leslie for a planning session. Some of the people were from the church, some were neighbors, some, you know, connected to the convent, and that began to really explore who she is as an individual.
With Leslie's guidance, the group discovered a young woman who was creative, spiritual, helpful and gentle. They learned she loved music, dancing, cooking and rug hooking.
From that, all kinds of possibilities came forward. She became more involved in the church, but she would be involved with other people without her mom being present. Things that she would help make the crosses at Easter out of the palms. She started dancing in the church. She's a liturgical dancer, so they were inviting her to dance. Not just necessarily in a group, but also as an individual. And that led to other opportunities. I think the most exciting thing that came out of it is that Leslie eventually, over a period of time where the group came together and helped facilitate this, became an associate for the Sisters of St. John the Divine at the convent. So now when she goes to the convent, she goes as Leslie. and they make sure that she dances during their services, and that she plays a vital role there on her own. You know, she is seen as the beautiful person that she is. And to me, that's an example of what magical things happen when people who care about you come together and brainstorm ways of you living out the life that you were meant to live. And so that the convent and the church are far richer for having Leslie now contributing the way she does. And certainly Leslie's life is much richer. And her network continues to meet and continues to dream about other opportunities for her.
We could spend a lot of time telling Leslie stories. One very quick. The assumption was, of course, Leslie didn't read and write. But when we put up the circles to see who was in her life, she willingly took the pens and filled them out. Turns out she was taking literacy lessons, but didn't bother to tell anybody, didn't want to embarrass them, but she was bilingual and literate. But more important, as Lynda was listening to what Leslie said, as we were having our explorations, very quietly she said, "I'd like to cook spaghetti." And Lynda said, "Tell me about that." And that's how we found out that her big dream was to cook spaghetti for the nuns and become an associate of the Order of St. John. And it required a massive amount of work for over a year and special study programs and all kinds of permissions. But Leslie and several others are now associates. A dream that was unknown, unacknowledged, until we listened to spaghetti.
So Patrick Howell, a fellow from New Zealand, summarized these patterns of conversation of path and maps this way. He said, "Path moves you forward and maps builds you up. Maps centers on listening for gifts." And it is really important that with any of the practices we use, that there really is thoughtful preparation, getting to know a person, really getting ready for the conversation. There's having the conversation and the meeting itself, but if that's the only thing that happens, and there is no taking action and then checking in to reflect about what have we done, what's working, what's not working, taking more action in time, and then in time checking in again, if it's not more than a meeting, we would encourage you not to do it. You will break somebody's heart. Because we can do all the person-centered planning in the world, but if we don't really believe that people have an important and distinctive contribution to make, we just end up processing them in a different way, says Beth Mount.
And listening in to someone else's story, this one from England, about how important it is to listen.
Well, yeah, I think it's helpful to listen to Ed Charter's story by thinking about these valued experiences, this quality framework, which is really underneath and grounds all of the work that we're doing, really thinking about what's worth working for, thinking about the importance of contribution and valued role and being respected, thinking about the qualities and attributes somebody has, thinking about the valued roles that they play, supporting people to share typical places, to have autonomy and choice, and to really experience connection, relationships, and belonging. And so listening to what matters to Ed Charters is reflected. And I think you can listen in for these valued experiences as we listen to his story.
I came to the first inclusion conference here and heard a story about a little girl who was asked what she wanted to be when she grew up. And she said a lorry driver. And because this little girl had severe difficulties, she couldn't walk, she was in a wheelchair, everybody thought that wasn't possible. This little girl had to explain what a lorry driver does, which is basically drive from A to B, delivering the goods. So what does Judith Snow do now? She travels the world from A to B, delivering the goods, lecturing on inclusion and issues connected with it. And when I heard that, I got goose pimples in that conference because I had just sat in my son's school with one of his teachers and a careers advisor. When he was asked the same question as Judith, what would you like to be when you grow up? And he said, I'd like to be a policeman. And he was told straight away that he was not, that wouldn't be possible, he wasn't intelligent enough to be a policeman. And in that one sentence, not only was his dreams shattered, his reason for working hard at school was removed. And I now realise that you have to listen to what people are saying and unpack it, because what my son meant by wanting to be a policeman was he wanted to wear a uniform, he wanted to work with people, and he wanted to be in service. Well, actually, my son's now living his dream, because he always said he wanted to own his own business, and nobody really believed him, but he's so determined, and he's made it happen. He has his own business, Personal Butler Services, and he's a butler and a chauffeur for everybody, including people with different needs. So his vehicle is adapted with a ramp and a winch, and he can help and serve everybody. It's just the same as wanting to be a policeman. It's the same issues. People didn't listen and unpack what he really wanted to be. But a couple of weeks ago, we were telephoned by the organiser of this conference, Derek Wilson, to see if Edward, his business, could collect a lady called Judith Snow and bring her from the South to the conference. This Judith Snow had wanted to be a lorry driver when she was little, and I suddenly realised that this Judith Snow was this person I'd heard at that first inclusion conference, the person who'd made me realise that people can achieve their dreams, and that when my son said, I want to be and I want to do, I had to listen and totally believe in him. So I learnt that from Judith, and I learnt to believe in my son. And he ends up driving Judith Snow to this inclusion conference. And I've just met Judith Snow.
So there are qualities that we think we bring when we're at our best as facilitators to this work. And that is, really need to believe in the person. When we sink in and think about what are the qualities, what's the interior condition, what's the intention we need to bring, we really need to believe in the person, to listen deeply, to be listening and looking for capacities and ways to seek connections in new ideas that will emerge, really being open to yes, just listening for possibility, being open to explore what matters and hold that question about what more is possible. We've really also learned a great deal about the importance of presence and really holding space to deeply listen. And the words of Heather Platt, we find really helpful here in thinking about the intentions as facilitators. Holding space means that we're willing to walk alongside another person in whatever journey they're on without judging them, making them feel inadequate, trying to fix them, or trying to impact the outcome. When we hold space for other people, we open our hearts, offer unconditional support, and let go of judgment and control. a lifelong practice and effort at getting stronger, at letting go to be fully present.
This is also ancient wisdom. And here we have Musashi, a samurai warrior, whose mantra was to practice day and night until sword becomes no sword and intention becomes no intention. And the mastery we have to be good facilitators and to be good at this work are we need to be masterful at listening deeply. We need to be masterful at holding questions so that we invite people's content, not control it. And we need to be masterful at getting clarity and supporting agreements so we don't disappoint when we accidentally forget our commitments. Clear supporting agreements. John O'Brien says, when people not used to speaking out are heard by people not used to listening, then real changes can be made. John has many elements of wisdom.
It's also helped us really think about listening and ways, in fact, that sometimes we really are pretending to listen. It's not, we're really not taking it in. We're downloading, we're ignoring when we're listening. We're really thinking about what we have to say, not holding the space for someone else. And there's times that we're selectively listening. We just either hear what affirms or disagrees. We're not taking in the entirety of it. We're selectively listening. Then there's active listening, where you really are leaning in and holding the space to take in all of what's someone's saying with open mind and open heart. And then there is open will, where there is something new that is created because of the kind of listening that can happen when something new is generated and it is profound. Really the deepest kind of listening.
Another person teaches us about listening. Christine Mayer went through, I think it was 36 group homes before she was listened to. And then she told us this. If you're going to work with me, you have to listen to me. And you can't just listen with your ears because it'll go to your head too fast. You have to listen slow with your whole body. If you listen slow with your whole self, some of what I say will enter your heart. If you listen slow with your whole self, some of what I say will enter your heart. And so, we have no doubt that you have fears and doubts, and it's important to acknowledge them. Give them respect, because it'll matter. But as we move forward with hope and courage. That's where you think and act from. And so, don't waste your energy demonizing and whining and carrying on. It's not going to help. But be intentional. Listen. Build relationships. You see, we aren't really crazy, and you are not alone. And the time to start is now. And so we end.
Thank you, Jack and Lynda. Wow, that was so powerful. I'm sure others are like me. I took lots of notes, and I probably will be reflecting on your thoughts and ideas for many days to come. We want to take a few minutes here to open it up. Feel free to put it on gallery view if you'd like to see all the faces. Feel free to turn on your mic if you have a question for Jack and Lynda or a thought. Also, feel free to use the chat box if that's more convenient for you. For it.
So this is a complex question. I was listening to what you're saying, just going, yeah. And but one of the things that struck me is that my ability to learn to actively listen and to cultivate relationships had to come from personal experience, like a lot of experience. Like I had to have, I had to go through my own stuff to get to the point where I can really build relationships. So I wanted to kind of ask how folks going forward can kind of dig a little deeper and not just in the concept of, yeah, I need to build relationships, but what does that really look like? Like, do you have any, like, where can people go to dig a little deeper on that?
You know, it really has been very powerful for me to connect into, honestly, mindfulness practice, mm-hmm. centering practice, really thinking. You are quite correct about how big we actually think the holding space and the work of becoming present to really clear the entire committee who's so busy up there making judgments and thinking about how, oh, I know the answer. The time I know that I spend really trying to quiet all that down so that I'm in some regular presence and mindfulness practice, I have noticed that I'm really drawn. There's certain podcasts that I'm listening to. There are people that I'm following to really strengthen that practice because it makes a difference in the quality of my facilitation. There's a quote in the Path and Maps handbook that I think is something like, the interior condition of the intervener has everything to do with the quality of the outcome. And that's Bill O'Brien, I think. And the other one I think that you really will like is, you can't get to wonderful without passing through all right. There is just, you are exactly right about the fact that there is no way except to practice, pay attention, get some feedback, be in it with some other people. And I think that matters. I think you're absolutely right about the nature of the work. And that's why I was saying at the outset, I really think a lot about the quality that we bring and how to cultivate that and really start to pay attention to responding and not reacting, to notice our shadow side, what activates us, so that you can calm it down to really be available for someone. Does that make sense?
Oh, that was an awesome answer. Thank you.
And there isn't one answer. There's your answer. Because it is your life, your experience that you're building on. So I think you need to identify your own rituals, your own practices that work for you to calm yourself, to strengthen yourself so that you can do this work well. And the obverse of that is notice when you're slipping, because that also will happen. And that's okay. That's part of the deal. But build and use your own practices, whatever they are. Just find ones that work for you.
You know, the other thing that I would add is that I have come to appreciate that I am not only a facilitator when we're engaged in one of these planning conversations. I bring those intentions when I'm at my best into all of my relationships with my family, with my boyfriend, husband, Jack. I mean, there's a culture to that I think really makes a difference. And I'll say in no small measure, a little therapy hasn't been a bad thing for the quality of my practice. And I saw in the chat, I love the question about defining gifts. It's one of the, that's been a defining question for me. And I think that it has to do with the qualities and attributes, capacities that we have. And I think there are gifts of the head, of the hand, of the heart, of our history, and that you can cultivate a practice of listening to any story, even when someone begins with, I don't think I have any gifts. If someone will share with you a story of a time they felt good about or remembered as meaningful to them, and you can listen in and begin to name the gifts that you hear, and it's a practice you can develop and strengthen to listen for what are the gifts that someone has, the qualities, attributes, talents, capacities. And that's the place. I really appreciate Judith Snow's point that that's the place to build from, not how to fix people and what's wrong with them.
Well, I think one of the things about gifts is we assume it's a something, or, you know, it's tangible, or you got to be doing something. But, you know, I can think of a young woman who had no speech and was not literate, but had the most spectacular smile. And she became the best literacy coach on the planet, as far as I'm concerned, because she would sit with someone who'd likely never been listened to and very shy about trying out their new words and their new reading practice. And she would listen intently and she would smile. And that gift was enormously powerful to people. It was more than the best regular tutor, whatever that means, could ever convey, her complete yep. acceptance and joy. So we want to be careful when we think about gifts. It doesn't have to be something like that. It's also a matter of spirit and heart. Yeah, we love Gabor Mate too. Yeah.
Michael, do you have a question?
Yeah. For the lack of, I hope this isn't considered rude. I hope one of these days we are able to break bread together. And I plan to, as soon as I get off, I'm going to look at a plane ticket. So if you think I'm kidding, ask Lisa. He doesn't kid about that. I thank you for sharing that. And I would love to meet you personally, both of you. And if you take me up on it, I'll come up to Toronto or wherever the heck you are, because you seem to travel a lot, and break bread with you. I hope I'm not too rude, considering you don't even know who I am. Would love to have some time with you and learn from you. And thank you for your time today.
Thank you, Michael. It was nice to talk with you before we all got started today.
Breaking bread's a great start. And we might even start with injera, which is Ethiopian sort of bread, where your whole meal is put out on the injera. Just could be a fun start. We'll see. Lots of kinds of bread.
I'm game. I'm game.
Okay.
If you would like to.
We have a question in the chat box from Lou. Please review the difference between maps and path. And I know that is a long answer.
Yeah.
Go ahead and take that.
Well, we can try and do a short answer. And one is, I can start, Jack, and you can add. The maps process really starts from inviting someone to reflect on some stories from their life that have to do with their purpose. So it starts from history and story, and then thinks about your dream, and is a very reflective process that's listening into every conversation for naming the gifts and thinking how they're contributed. So it starts from history. So think about it here on the timeline. And path starts from the future and thinks backwards. So it invites reflections about your purpose and what matters most to you, and gathers an image and some of the meaning that for you, and then moves to a conversation about, if things went really well, what would have happened in a year or two? So it is starting from the future and thinks backwards. So the first couple of conversations are purpose and vision. And then you think about, and where are you now? And who do you need to enroll? And what would it take to stay strong? And what are the action steps? That's it, a little ass nutshell.
Yeah.
Well done.
Boyfriend, anything you want to add?
There's books and videos on that. The only thing I think I might add, maps, you know, we began with circles and that turned into maps because we were trying to figure out how to get people to identify their gifts and supports. And that was going along fine, but sometimes, and that's where the references to trauma start to come in, some people's stories are just bloody gruesome and painful. And so we kept bumping into people's stories that were really, really hard. And we thought, well, you know, it feels so, it's too hard to go back there. So can we get to the starting point of what do you do in the morning anyway by doing it differently? And so we invented PATH. So instead of starting with history, we sort of set it aside and we went to the future dream, your North Star, where you really want to go. And once we've got the direction nailed down and we invent both a long vision version and where you want to be in a year or two from now, and then work backwards. So what do you have to do to get there? So the maps is a very reflective process that sort of is great for crossroads. I'm at a crossroads in my life. I'm not sure who I am or where I want to go next. All kinds of different crossroads happen to us in life. And that's a good time to recollect who I am and what my gifts are. That's a maps process time. And if you know where you want to go and just not sure how to get there, PATH is a really good process for, okay, so I know where I want to go. Let's figure out the steps I need to take. So it's an action program. So if you're going to sit and think, that's MAPS. If you're going to move it and act, that's PATH.
Interesting. I want a pathway.
I think we had a hand go up. Kat, did you have a question? Just stretching your hand. Any other questions for Jack and Lynda?
You've all been very generous. Yes, Catherine.
We have one that just came up. Catherine. And this will be our last question for today, and then we'll go into a little debrief on our cohorts.
Hi, how's everybody? So thanks. I just want, in the very beginning, when you were just sort of saying your mission, you were talking about like fears of person-centeredness and institutionalization. Now, institutionalization is a tough word. I work within a residential rehabilitation center where our mission is to have people move out into community settings. And so I train staff on person-centered practices and we infuse it into what we do. And it's, for me, it's like how we try to keep people empowered. And so I'm trying to understand your language around that and whether I'm part of your, if I'm part of the problem or part of the solution and in your viewpoint, or, you know, I'm just trying to understand that role.
Thank you, Catherine. You know, part of what I think about relates to what happens when convening a person-centered planning session really becomes a tick box. An annual event is not really grounded and led by the person. And I really suspect, Catherine, that you are working relentlessly to keep the heart of it true to being led by the person.
And
it's never over. I don't know if you've noticed that, but I find it can so easily slip into requiring a good thing and then not paying attention to the quality of it and checking with people about how it felt. And that sometimes the process itself can take over and we've lost the person. So that's not what we want.
No, and I have seen it with a few people where you have these incredible person-centered plans and then they get buried under a desk.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like you pull these things out, but like no one ever did anything with these plans. No one ever revisited them. They become this like, we heard everything you dream about, and then we're going to hide it in a desk somewhere and it's not going to be seen. So I believe that, you know, I know that that's like the worst, but I think there's a certain foundational support of like, when you look at what's important to and for a person and about validations and things like that, that become, you know, that person-centeredness is, it's also a way of thinking, it's a way of doing, and then it's planning. So there's like a certain like transformation in how we provide support and care that person-centeredness can really infuse.
Right, I think so. And I think you got to be open to talking about the interesting failures. We can't be saying, oh, please don't have that dream. I can't make it happen, because we're not supposed to make things happen. We're co-creating with people when we're at our
house. Some things are easy. I mean, it could be as easy to take somebody to the beach.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Lisa, when you connect with people, I don't have the link with me, but John O'Brien has a pretty terrific video we've posted on our website. Very short. It's called The Wellsprings of Person-Centered Planning. And Catherine, your question makes me think about how helpful it is to keep connected to the values underneath this, not ever to be doing it alone, right? Staying connected with other people about, and the people that we're walking with and planning for, how are we doing? And to really constantly be looking at the nature of the work. I think that's when we're at our best.
Totally. Right. Thank you. That's very helpful. Thank you so much. That's great.
And the fact that you're working from essentially a pretty tough place, that's extra work. Congratulations for hanging in, because there need to be really, really good people helping people even imagine the journey that they can make.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you so much.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
May the force be with
that thought-provoking question, and everybody else for participating. And back to Jack and Lynda, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us this morning.
May the force be with you.
Also with you.
Okay.
Thanks very much.
Bye. We're checking out. So later.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.